identify that when you see your patients or even with you that I'm not abnormal. I'm normal like everybody else. I'm not defined by who I am or the diagnosis. I am me. How do you feel about that? So I got some pictures up here indicating people who are going through different distresses of all backgrounds, cultural backgrounds, ethnic backgrounds on this picture. And this is some of the things that we're going to be getting into today. What is mental illness? Now, before you look at that, I want you guys to identify in your own words, what is mental illness? Anyone out there? Come on, folks. It can be brief.
Chronic disruption.
Clinic disruption, okay.
Chronic
disruption, okay, sorry about that.
Madness.
Okay, what else? Any identifiers?
Sadness.
What about feelings of hopelessness?
Mm-hmm.
Anxious, anxiety.
Failure,
trauma. Yes, ma'am, back there.
Feelings of insecurity.
Feelings of insecurity. A lack of sense of belonging.
Yeah.
Fear, anger, shame, and guilt.
Oh, yes, that's all in, yes, all in together. Fear, shame,
grief. Fear, anger, shame, pain, grief.
Yes, grief is a lot. And some of these things go undiagnosed, unrecognized. Mm-hmm. And sometimes when it happens, we fail to look at some of the symptoms. Yes.
Did someone say abnormal?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Well. Yeah. Normal. Okay. Yes.
Especially because in at least under my undergrad program, they called it abnormal psychology.
Yes.
Which in itself is like such a way to make a group of people feel isolated.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And isolation is a big key factor as well, mm-hmm. especially for some of our depressed patients. Something that we have to look into and try to help give them or inspire hope. So getting into mental illness refers to a wide range of mental health disorders that affect one's mood, thinking, and behavior. Mental health disorders include the following, but not solely limited to schizophrenia, anxiety, PTSD, bipolar disorder, and major depression. In this, if mental illness is not treated, symptoms can lead to severe emotional, behavioral, and physical problems, also psychological problems as well. The severity of mental illness can impair individuals' ability to function daily life, interpersonal relationships, occupational, social, it can impede the financial, vocational, so all areas it can impede in your daily lifestyle and daily functioning. The prevalence. And this is getting to populations now. Native Americans have lower levels of risk for major depression than whites, but are at a heightened risk for post-traumatic stress disorder and alcohol dependence. With that, compared to Caucasians, African Americans may have a higher level of schizophrenia. However, it's unrepresented and undiagnosable, or misdiagnosed. And getting to African Americans with schizophrenia are overrepresented in the state of psychiatric hospitals, evidence suggests that clinicians overdiagnose schizophrenia and underdiagnosed mood disorders in African Americans, due to clinical errors alone, are unlikely to account for the difference. Blacks, Hispanics, and Asians have a lower rate of lifetime mental disorders than compared to whites. And compared to our Caucasian population, Blacks and Hispanic are more likely to have mental disorders that are persistent and severe. Why do you believe that sometimes this goes undiagnosed when it comes to minorities?
Economic resources,
absolutely.
I think sometimes it's looked as Uncle Joe, they're just crazy.
Okay.
You know, it's kind of downplayed.
It's downplayed? I like that word. What about anyone else?
And a lot of black people really just don't go to the doctor the way they should.
That makes a difference, and we're going to get into that a little bit later. Any other ideas? Yes.
Denial.
Oftentimes, yes.
You're dealing with stigma from multiple.
Yes.
So if you're dealing from stigma because of race, then and then on top of it, compounded stigma because of potentially having a mental health issue,
mm-hmm.
it's like it's a lot. So maybe you don't want to seek help because you don't want that label on you.
Right.
On top of it.
Right. Absolutely. How many people have talked with patients, and this is proven in statistics as well, if someone doesn't look like you, they think they're unable to talk with you. You wouldn't be able to understand where they come from. Not only understand where they come from, but understand the culture. So they're uncomfortable. So either two things happen. They prematurely leave and they don't get the help that they need. Or another thing, which is the higher thing, just suicide, because they can't get the help that they need. Demographics. Just want you to just deal an eye on that about our population. 13.2, the US population identifies as Black or African American. Out of those, 16% have a diagnosable mental health illness in the past year. This is over 6.8 million people. In 2010, more than one-third of the U.S. population identified themselves as a member of a racial or ethnic minority group. By 2050, it is projected that these groups will account for nearly half of the U.S. population. The landmark report, Culture, Race, and Ethnicity, documented the lack of access and the poor quality of mental health care among minorities. By 2050, Hispanic Latino population group is expected to double to 132.8 million, making up approximately 30% of the total U.S. population. Patients are less likely to receive diagnosis and treatment for a mental illness and are more likely to die by suicide. Ethnic minority patients are even less likely to get the help. Getting more into population. There are 5.2 million American Indians and Alaskan Natives in the United States. That makes up about 1.7 of the total population. Out of that, American Indians and Alaskan Native Americans experience some of the highest rates of substance use and mental disorders compared to other U.S. racial or ethnic groups. In 2014, 3.8 of African American adults ages 18 and older had a past mental illness and a substance use disorder, while the national average was 3.3. The 2014 national average for any mental illness in the past year for adults was 18.1%, compared to the 16.3% for African American adults. Now, when we start getting into mental health, and I'm by trade especially substance abuse, we gotta add in the substance abuse component. A lot of times, people come into the office, they self-medicate. You wanna know why they self-medicate? What are some of the rationales for self-medication? Okay, it could be side effects of prescription drug. What else? What are we here talking about today?
They're masking other problems with substance abuse to kind of deal.
A certain percentage of these members have a mental health disorder that has not been diagnosed. So a lot of the self-medication comes from those members who are not properly diagnosed, and they self-medicate to deal with their pain, to cope with their issues. And I can tell you that there are unrepresented populations, a mass majority would either sit home and continue to self-medicate. They won't seek out the help due to cultural beliefs, due to their moral and core values. They refuse to seek treatment.
A lot of them are religious because they think they just pray to God.
Absolutely. Yes.
I work for an advocacy organization, and a lot of times we've heard that people will go to seek help for a mental health issue, and they also have a substance use issue, and sometimes they've been told, I can't help you until you stop drinking first and then come back.
That is so true. And that is totally a myth. When two entities come together, we call it a co-occurring disorder, which is dual diagnosis, and we treat them simultaneously. We can't treat one and not treat the other. So with that being said, we treat the substance abuse and we treat the mental health. How do we get a patient to be mentally stable or have stability? How do we outreach? The first step is making sure you have a psychiatrist due to the medication management. The second case is making sure they have the individual therapist to make sure those interpersonal issues are addressed. The second thing, you have me for IOP, intensive outpatient treatment, inpatient treatment, or traditional outpatient treatment to address the substance use. So while all of this wraparound service is going on, statistics has proven that this works. This is a hopeful treatment outcome. Matter of fact, it is a treatment outcome. I was just at the opioid, training on Thursday. It was a Baltimore initiative for community solutions to develop new ways of how we can attack the epidemic of fentanyl. It is something that are taking people out at drastic measures with the mixtures. A kilo of heroin, where it now costs about maybe, as they say, $20,000, whatever it might be, to 200 pills of fentanyl, or a kilo of fentanyl, which costs us $2,000. You do the math. We're gonna go get fentanyl, and we're gonna use it. This is something that is scary. We don't have a lot of providers that are providing OTP maintenance. And what I mean by that, medication assistant therapy, to help these patients not only remain abstinent, but remain abstinent the long term. So that's why we have different medications to help as far as Vivitrol injectables, naltrexone injectables, Suboxone, methadone, to help these patients, number one, survive and try to live a successful life. There have been tremendous successful treatment outcomes merging mental health and substance abuse treatment because they need both. Okay, I'm sorry, I have that substance abuse hat on, so excuse me. But anyway, getting back to mental health. Percentage of people ages 18 and up reporting a past year mental illness was 15.6%. About 3.5% of the adult Hispanic or Latinos had a serious mental illness. Percentages of people who reported a major depressive episode was 5.6%. And 3.3% of this population had a co-occurring, which consisted of mental health and substance abuse disorder. What are some of the risk factors? What are some of the risk factors for populations as a whole? Any guesses? Yes.
Overall, I don't know if it's specific, but overall trauma for everyone.
Trauma for everyone. It's a good one. Absolutely. What else? What are some of the significant risk factors? By looking at the screen. Shouldn't turn. What are some of the risk factors?
Bias.
Huh? Biases. Stigma. Yes.
Known and unknown.
No. Good one. Yes. Known and unknown. Yes.
Poverty.
Poverty.
Yes.
Yes. Huh?
Stress.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Stress is a big one.
Turned out good.
Absolutely. Poverty is another one. I think you mentioned about the social economic status, SES, earlier. That's a big one. People of color are disproportionately represented in poverty, either below the poverty level or at the poverty level, or just above it. Black and African men are concerned, particularly concerned about the stigma. Participants, and this is a study by WellWack, participants appear apprehensive about seeking professional help for mental health issues, which is consistent with previous research. However, participants were willing to seek help. So they were willing to seek help, but not professional help. So when we talk about seeking help, what are some of the things that come to your mind? Support groups. They would do the less restrictive help as they possibly could without seeking professional guidance. So those are your SMART recovery meetings, your NAAA meetings, your GA meetings, your CA meetings, which Cocaine Anonymous, Gambling Anonymous, trauma support groups, they have them everywhere. Even with for sexual abuse, they have that too as well. I had a couple of sexual anonymous groups for those who are addicted to pornography. So it's a lot of support groups, and a lot of these people, they're just not so amped to just reach out and ask for help. They don't want to do it. A lot of times in your family, bro, a lot of things are stuck and stay in the family. Things are not revealed outside. That's like a big no-no in certain cultures. You know, dealing with different cultures, we have to be sensitive to the different and have understanding of the difference. And a lot of us, we don't. That's very challenging for some. When a patient to you is divulging that they're being deceptive, how do you confront it? How comfortable do you feel confronting that issue? A lot of trained clinicians are not comfortable with doing that. A lot of trained clinicians are not continuing with the new trends of therapy to keep yourself abreast of how to treat this population. Mental health disparities. What is it? What is mental health disparities? It's unfair differences in access to or quality of care according to race, ethnicity, are quite common in mental health. We brought up many variations to that as far as stigma, preconceived notions, biases. Stigma regarding mental health often fosters fear of the system. resulting in a greater proportion of ethnic minorities who are wary about mental health care compared to Caucasian Americans. Disparities in mental health exhibit a decidedly different pattern from disparities in health. Take this back in general. Minorities, particularly African Americans, have poor health and health outcomes than compared to their counterparts. Hispanic Americans have advantages compared with white Americans at younger and older ages, but are disadvantaged during the middle years. Only Asian Americans, with the exception of Hawaiian Natives, hold an overall advantage in health. Mistrust, and we can talk about this all day, I actually could spend 4 hours on this. Mistrust of medical professionals stems from well-documented historical accounts of unethical treatment of ethnic minorities in research and practice. So I'm gonna read that one more time. So mistrust of medical professionals stems from well-documented historical accounts of unethical treatment of ethnic minorities in research and practice. How many people ever been on the phone with their loved one and the first question was seeking out to get help? What type of insurance do you have? What type of insurance do you have? That's the label. Okay, well, for example, I have Medicaid. Oh, well, we can see what we can do. Let's see what you come up with and what happens to see how many authorizations we can get. You guys know the drill. Oh, you have Blue Cross? Okay, let's see if we can get you in, ma'am, right here on this day, such and such. Why is that? Why is this disparity with commercial insurance and state insurance? What do we see that? Why do you believe that to be true, the disparities?
It's about
at the end of the day, about getting paid.
Policies.
Policies.
Restrictions.
Restrictions.
For profit.
For profit, absolutely. So in that, people who are trying to seek out help, and when you kind of get them on that cuff, when they're attempting to get help, they're often denied. You have a lot of agencies around the area that don't take Medicaid.
That's right. I'm sorry, could you explain that a little bit more? I kind of got lost in that.
With the insurance companies?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So what happened is, you have a set amount or allocated through your insurance carrier. So say for instance someone who has Medicaid versus finding someone who has commercial insurance such as UBH or Blue Cross Blue Shield or Care First, Okay. Those people with Medicaid are often denied. Matter of fact, some agencies are not able to take it. Right. So I'm going to put you an example. I had a patient that was in my clinic who had a benzodiazepine addiction. I wanted to send him to the traditional inpatient treatment, ward management. This patient had Medicaid. We're compared, and I see the difference. Compared to a patient with CareFirst, this patient only got 2 weeks of inpatient treatment. 2 weeks. And you know with benzodiazepine and Xanax, it takes at least 7 to 14 days to withdraw off of it, depending on how heavy they're using. So 2 weeks, did it really benefit him compared to a 30-day treatment program?
No.
And what happened? After he got treatment, he resumed back to my program. Of course, we had to do IOP, then step them down into OP, and then send them back out with the necessary OTP maintenance. Okay, so we had to connect that. Once you leave a treatment program, they don't give you the notes and bolts of how to continue on. It's like, I'm gonna shove you to the next person, you're good, you're an advocate, okay, that's fine, I'm done. And then it's your responsibility as clinicians to ensure that the facilitation of aftercare is proceeded throughout. Yes?
So it's like, with the Medicaid is the stepping stones of the process that you have to go through versus being able to go through a straight process with commercial insurance.
I can attest it's very challenging for the person with Medicaid.
I do have a question.
Yes.
I know years ago we always heard that going postal.
Okay.
And how it was linked to, people basically losing their mind, I guess, the stress and all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
Now with employers, I just wanted to know the insight of employers now seeking, being available to get their employers.
EAP?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Okay.
EAP is established on just about every job, and if it's not, it should be. EAP is actually a helpful service to us. What gives anywhere free from 6 to 8 sessions, depending on your agency, for you to seek help on the agency's dime. Sometimes we fall short with not balancing our work life, our personal life, any other parts of us. And stressors come and we become overwhelmed. I have a few of my colleagues who take work home I tell them it's unacceptable. And the reason why is because you're working 24 hours and you're so fixated on this problem at work, you have to leave that at work and save for another day. I feel short for that, especially being a new clinician too. I want to make sure that I have everything, every T crossed, every I dotted. I didn't want to leave until I had it. Sometimes I find myself working on the weekend. I was like, whoa, wait a minute. This is just burnout, totally burnout. And we all fall short of that because we're trying. We're so passionate about what we do and we're trying to give it our all. But you got to forget, you have to live and you lose self. And you need to know how to balance your self-care, not only that, have boundaries
yes.
between work and personal. What are some of the barriers of treatment? Lack of providers who speak the patient's language can be a barrier to accessing and receiving mental health care. It's very hard or challenging when you have a Hispanic-speaking client and you don't have any Hispanic-speaking clinicians. And you're on the phone with the translation line. And for me, I find it really is not helpful to me. A lot of stuff gets mixed up when you're talking in the phone to the translator. The dissemination to the patient could be very different. And the information that you're seeking can frustrate the patient, where they say, I'm done, I give up. Yes.
And even translating with families, the terminology is not the same. Medical terminology, regular lexicon, it comes across different.
Different, absolutely. So it's always good for us, we contract out with Astro, and that's a translation company, so they come to us. And when we're sitting with the patient, we're actually seeing the translation live. I'm looking at the patient, it's a certain way you have to do the translate. When the translation happens, you look directly at that patient, your translator translates everything you say. And that just gives, you know, them the respect, the eye contact, and it builds rapport. And that's what it's about at the end of the day, making sure we treat that patient accordingly. Oh yes, yes. And you can begin to empathize with them and provide support. The shortage of specialties in the minority communities means that finding a mental health practitioner may be a challenge. This is definitely a big challenge. We don't have enough medical professionals of our descent in the field. And it makes it very hard for others to seek out mental health treatment. Stigma and judgment prevents Black African Americans from seeking treatment for their mental illness. Educational levels play a big factor as well. The willingness of people of color to seek treatment. Had a hard time. A gentleman came into the office, highest level education was ninth grade. And it's like, will I be able to fit in here? This is a group, I'm really embarrassed, my reading's not good, I can't write, I can't do, he's overly anxious. I can't do any of this. What are you going to, how can I finish treatment? And he was just shaking. I'm just like, it's okay. Sir, just relax. This program is suitable for everyone's needs. And what happened? You have a one clinician doing a one-to-one, sitting with him, going over the paperwork for his understanding. And he works at his own pace to finish the material. We have to be cognizant of that. A lot of people, we don't only speak languages to patients that, you know, it's way over their level. They have no understanding of what you're talking about, and they're sitting there agreeing with you because of shame and embarrassment. So you have to make sure that whatever population that you're addressing, you have to recognize the educational factors. Effects of discrimination is another barrier to treat. 25% of the Black male population, for example, is under some sort of judicial system, supervision, jail, probation, and this can result in a sense of depression, helplessness, hopelessness in minority communities. This is where you become educated. Greater exposure to a primary care physician and integration of behavioral health increases the chances of detecting mental illness and reducing disparities in access. Increasing the availability of culturally relevant and informed mental health services accessible to minorities. Also, increasing opportunities for training minority mental health professionals. Developing and implementing services, programs, and policy to ensure minorities are empowered through cultural informed, practice-based evidence. and conducting studies that can guide psychopharmacology treatments for patients from different ethnocultural backgrounds. When you're treating patients or even within different cultures across the board, a lot of folks are not up to psychopharmacology treatment, medication. So what do? You have a patient who comes into your office, and at the first intake, they say, listen, I know I have this issue, but I'm not taking medicine. How do you treat that patient? And you know they're severely depressed, they're down on their last, they're going through a divorce currently, they're homeless. What I mean by homeless, they stay from place to place, but they're still considered homeless because they have no identified address.
Right.
Okay? How do you help this patient? What do you do? Yes?
Well, I think it's the responsibility of a mental health provider,
yes,
to develop trust between that patient and themselves.
Okay. Okay. What else are you doing with your patient?
I guess you would have to navigate around the drugs. I mean, because sometimes some people want to go pull a list, ways, that won't have a lot of other than that. Because medication is like you're taking it for this, but it can affect that. So some people are leery about, because I am too, literally all these side effects going to come with this medication.
Exactly. You can sorry.
With education, I see a nurse in my vision, and any medication that he prescribes, he goes into detail with the side effects. He said, do not drink. I said, well, you must know I drink a medium wine every now and then. He said, no. He said, it will cause you to have a seizure. And the psychiatrist I had before, she would never just say that. Now, he could go, that's it. But he breaks it down. So that helps a lot.
That is very helpful. I think it's responsibility of us as medical providers to educate our patients on medication management. It is up to them to ask questions to their psychiatrist about side effects and why we're taking it. If our psychiatrist don't thoroughly explain to you, patients probably would not take it. And I've had that before where we had to change psychiatrists because of that reason, because it wasn't explaining and it was helpful. Those who are strongly against medication, we educate them about other treatments, holistic treatments. Okay, a lot coming from mindfulness, music therapy, art therapy. There are a lot of other plethora of activities that they can use in place of medication. We see how that works.
It's almost excited because it's because you are doing your best to treat the disease.
Absolutely.
And anything that you can do to help treat that disease and have them cope.
Right.
It may not always be medication.
That's right.
What's really going on.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think it's very helpful to just, I know sometimes I feel a show. When I have a patient that I know that's really struggling, because our program meets on Monday, Tuesdays, and Thursdays, sometimes I'll call that patient on Friday and say, hey, what's your daily weekend schedule? What are your activities for the weekend? Because that's really important. Because you never know a person who's on the verge of suicide if you don't make that call. We have all the assessments in the world and screening tools to rule out suicide. But if I know I have this person that doesn't really sit easy with me, and they were kind of flat in group, I'm going to make that phone call Friday. Are you okay? Let's go to a meeting on Saturday. What's your activities? And I think that's helpful. When you do things like that, it shows that you care. It shows that you want them back. And it shows that you're building rapport with that patient.
And that they're important.
And that they're important. Absolutely. We talked about advocacy, and there's so many advocacy groups out here to help. Most in my life, because I like it so much, SHAMHSA, you have NOMNY, you have a whole plethora of other advocacy groups that are actually working, doing the grassroots to get this stuff taken care of. With that, national and local levels, public health advocates are training or taking steps to remove disparities and provide care to communities that most need it, our underprivileged communities, okay? Those people who are unrepresented. You have SAMHSA develop the Office of Behavioral Health Equity as a result of the Affordable Care Act to address disparities and promote quality of care for all. They have a minority fellowship program which works to reduce health disparities and improve healthcare outcomes of racially and ethnically diverse population, trains an average of 120 mental health practitioners each year. More than 600 psychologists of color have been trained for this program. Let's look at providers. Healthcare professionals must be able to provide effective care for increasingly diverse communities, and the cultural diversity of health workforce must reflect diversity in society. Clinicians should be prepared to take into account the ways in which racism and anti-immigrant sentiments contribute to depression and anxiety in minority populations. We also may take into account and show some interest in providing treatment to minority populations. We should be mindful of ways minority group membership can affect mental health. People of color face unique mental health risk factors as compared to other ethnic groups. And we talked about risk factors when it came to poverty, you know, looking at the socioeconomical statuses, looking at the force of discrimination and racism with certain treatment, even balancing out the disparity with insurance companies of seeking treatment, even when you're ready to do that and commit to it. The last, be cautious of stereotypes. Clinicians with prejudicial views of minority groups can be particularly harmful to the people they treat in therapy. If a client seeks that you're uneasy about their cultural background, or they seek any fear upon coming as far as presentation, the likelihood of them coming back, they won't. They will prematurely discharge themselves and you will never hear from them again. As clinicians, you have to be open to the difference. And if you feel uncomfortable with treating a person minority, refer them out. Because you never know, that may be that person's first opportunity to seek out for treatment, and we need to catch them early. And last but not least, integrated community collaborative care. It involves all of us. It comes from primary care physician, starts with mental health care, comes with justice in courts. The judicial branch is very, very helpful. And I can tell you, in the judicial system, things have changed. I can tell you for a fact, because I work well with mental health court, that it was a one point in time that they wouldn't even take our recommendations and apply the practice. That was a no-no. Either the client do it their way, and that's it. If they violate, they're going back to jail. Now we are opening up the vision in our eyes that, listen, let's apply your treatment plan with our treatment plan, combine it together, and make it work. Now they're asking me, what's your recommendation? How do we treat this client? It takes a village, community, advocacy, education. It takes all of us to be a part of this process, okay? And you can tell the successful outcomes in the judicial court system at this point right now, because of this initiative with mental health. Community care. Having community events such as this. Making people knowledgeable. Building their awareness is very important. Education and school health. We're in the schools right now. Educating. Preventative measures. Right here in the Maryland area. Transportation. It's nothing like a patient who's seeking treatment and don't have the transportation. Mm-hmm.
That's a big thing.
That is a big barrier to treatment, is transportation. We have to make sure that we can assist this patient.
That's what they started using with the transportation with people getting back and forth, like dialysis, the doctor's appointments,
yes.
Because people are dying and getting very ill and they can't get to the doctor.
And it's our responsibility for the continuity of care to ensure that this patient is able to get to and from.
What I'm finding is this, because everything is getting so specialized, it is extremely difficult to coordinate with other, you know, because there's, again, it's all, we all have that time, we all have the same 168 hours a week. So how do we even make time for more of that communication, that cross communication with the housing, with justice?
You have outreach. So for us, and I can only speak for our department, we have our trained clinician and we have our case managers. Our case managers are responsible for outreach. That's what they do. So when it comes to housing, when it comes to setting up psychiatric appointments, when it comes to getting back and forth with transportation, they handle that piece for our patients. So when it comes to integrative care, as a clinician, I'm gonna get back to that, you have to make sure that you have all the elements. And what I mean by that, when you're doing assessments, you're assessing the patient needs of what they need prior to the coming, when they come in. And when you're assessing the needs, you'll be able to build a significant treatment plan from that to make sure that you are able to accommodate their needs. So if housing is an issue on their need, in which I would have them, I measured out by levels, from severity all the way down to the lower risk. And we work from there. So if housing is a need, my first thing, if you don't have stable housing, the first thing we have, the crisis center if it's available for your needs. We have homeless shelters that's available. If you can research to do that. We have sober living houses that give scholarships. You even have treatment, other advocacy programs that give scholarships for treatment. So you have to really build your network.
It's just stunning how the ratio of work is just going up across the board.
Yes, and a lot of that too, you're right. A lot of that too with us, and I find myself, is due to us being burnt out because we're trying so hard to do it, but we're burning ourselves out too as well. On the flip side, because we want to make sure.
The government needs to allocate more money for us.
Oh yeah, of course.
Something has to give.
Something does have to give, exactly. I agree. Yes. So that actually with references, that concludes my presentation, and I can take questions if yes.
Also, when we talk about cultural demographics, as in, you know, from county to county.
Oh yes, difference. Mm-hmm. Big difference.
But you know, because like I know DC has so many things versus Prince George's County and Montgomery County. How it's like, can't everyone just get on one page and take care of our people?
Can I tell you something? Coming from Montgomery County and going to Prince George's, I did not see there's a big discord. There are limited services for mental health in Prince George's County.
Yes.
And I was not aware until I was brought into the fold of trying to advocate, well, get this patient this and do this. You know, coming out, and this is with the jail system. So I was just like, when patients are coming out, we have to have a plan. They're sending the inmates out when they finish their time. They're sending them out without Medicaid. They're wanting to get this plethora of services. But in order to get services, you need insurance. And you know this. So why not we have our case managers in the jail system making sure these inmates have insurance when they're coming out so they can access the treatment services. What happens? They come right back. And so that's something with bridging the gap. And that's something what I am trying to do on my end is bridging the gap between the judicial system and healthcare.
And the main reason why they're probably in the system is because they have the issue with mental health.
Absolutely.
They got them in that situation.
Absolutely. And I'm a passionate about substance abuse. I mean, this is just me. You put a person in there who is coming off of heroin, and you let them do it cold turkey. That is just so very fatal. Yes. And I'm very passionate about that, too. So I really have that initiative going that we need to be able to treat these patients and be able to monitor these patients as if they were in a hospital setting. We would have to. Yes. Yes, I work from, let's see, my youngest to 13, all the way up to my oldest patient was 75. That was in my intensive outpatient program. Hispanic descent, alcoholism, yes. Yes, yes.
My problem is, particularly healthcare, PG coverage, I'm into a conference. He was saying every time any patient that is discharged, they make sure they have insurance, they make sure they have a social worker, and they make sure they're able to get their medicine. But guess what everything he was talking about, the behavior health,
yes,
was not going up to him.
Absolutely.
I said, you know, what is the process? He's like, you know, I understand we need a lot of work. Okay, we need a lot of work, but to me, that's like the critical one. You have follow-up, make sure we have our medicine, make sure, you know, there's a plan of action. And it's still not happening. It hasn't happened, unfortunately.
Continuum care is very important. If we don't,
it's like half and half. It's like sloppy.
Well, it's almost like a piece. You know, it's a piecemeal. Mm-hmm. When a person comes in for their assessment, you should be planning for discharge. Mm-hmm. Anytime a person comes in at day one, we're planning for discharge. We're building the wraparound service. We're calling the psychiatrists. We're calling individual therapists. We're making sure housing is straight. We have a family support program right now that we just started in January that's booming. Families come in and get served on Tuesday evenings from 6:30 to 8:30. They're getting educated on disease model. They're getting educated on their recovery. Because when you're dealing in the midst of this, you lose yourself as well. Because you're trying to compensate for the child. Not only that, trying to accommodate their every need. So it's very helpful. So when you bring the family in part to treatment, you'll be amazed at the outcomes. I had one particular client, this family. He lived with his mom and dad. They were of Ethiopian descent. And what happened was, his dad said, look, if you don't stay in treatment, you can't come back here. You know how long it took him to be that strong to say those words? It took him 7 years because he kept enabling his son, enabling him, giving him money, crashed cars. You know what the insanity part of it was? His son crashed a car under the influence of Xanax, called his father. Father came and took the charge, said that he was driving. That's the insanity of how much he was enabling his son. He actually drove to the scene and said he was driving the vehicle. So his son wouldn't get in trouble. But just a matter of time, the trickle-down effect happened. Mm-hmm. And he did get a charge that was more severe, probably, than the first one. And that's what led him into treatment.
Yeah. I walked away, my apologies. You probably talked about this, but I'm a new graduate.
Okay. Congratulations.
Yeah. But what I find out is that in the minority community, particularly the African American community, there is a lack of awareness and resistance that we deal with, particularly among African American males, which is what I really want to work with. There's stigma around mental health and things like that. Even when they offer services available, trying to get African Americans to just ask for help is just very, very, as many have experienced, it's just very, very difficult. You know, just from a cultural perspective, I mean, can you just kind of talk about what are some of the things that we can do to get beyond that stigma of mental health and, let people know that, it's okay to ask for help. That doesn't mean that you're weak. And, how can we get that message out to, African-American organizations like churches and fraternities and sororities and, just different groups? How can we leverage those organizations to get that message out?
Go there. It starts with you. You go there. Grassroots. Yes, you build your team. You go to those churches. You ask to speak on there, whatever they may have in an event, and you bring your information to them. Showing that you care. We oftentimes, we speak about it, but we don't put action to it. Mm-hmm. If you want the message to get to these communities, you have to do the grassroots and go out and show the initiative.
And it might help to take in someone that maybe you serve to give some testimony of how it's helped them, so they can have a personal account.
Absolutely. I learned that working with males, their stigma, their discrimination, they feel like they are failing, they have a lot of trauma, they lost their families, they lost their kids, they lost their jobs, and the likelihood of them coming and bringing it to your hand wouldn't be likely. This young man said, the first thing he said, I am open and honest with you. You know why? Because I see that you care.
Right.
When you act like this is a routine for patients, they're not going to be open and honest with you. When you're not giving them the respect of just a basic eye contact prior to walking in, it starts there. At that first session, I cannot tell you how important that is. If you're not welcoming to that patient, they're not going to come back.
They read you.
They read you up and down.
Yeah.
They're not going to come back. It's just simple as a firm handshake. I forgot when I gave this gentleman a handshake. He said, oh my God, this handshake is so firm. Like, thank you. Like, do that again. And I'm just like, no, but they need to feel that you care and that you're genuine. This is not just getting a paycheck. This is actually, you're actually here to serve. And that's the difference. Any other questions?
I just have a comment.
Sure.
I guess this is, I guess my issue when you're going through the person episode, and, you know, stuff is kicking in and you really don't know what's right. And you go see a psychiatrist. See, they're asking you questions when your mind is just wobbled. You really can't answer those questions effectively. So I always try to say, is there maybe once that can come up, an advocate that go in with you? Because they're asking you questions, and really sometimes it's not even registering, and you might get misdiagnosed, or, you know, a lot of things can happen. And that's what I've, you know, kind of learned. So first they thought it was depression, then they thought it was something else, so.
Yes, unfortunately, when you go to a psychiatrist, they do their psychiatric eval. It's about maybe the first session, maybe about 45 minutes. Thereafter is 15 minutes. That's it. That's all you get. With that being said, usually I have individual therapists. I know for us, we automatically do all the screening forms. So for depression, PTSD, for suicide ideations, for GAD, for GAD-7. So when we send our patients to a psychiatrist, those screening forms attend their company so they can see the work that we've done and what we're sending them there for. And they're able to read through and assess it. And then from that point on, if we need an advocate, we can send someone with them. But the thing about us, we have a wraparound service that we have psychiatrists right next door. So we just walk them over there. So they're in the container. So when we walk them over there, our psychiatrists are familiar with our system. They see what we wrote. They see all our assessments that's in the EHR, you know, the EHR, electronic health record. And they can read it. They know before the client comes, what is it, what's the needs. So it makes it simplified. But with the advocate, a family member, I would suggest them attending that first appointment.
To pay back what you're, well, off what you're saying, three things. One, it's been biologically proven that when someone's in an emotional, you know, duress state, that there's an area of the brain called the Broca's area where it loses the language.
Yes,
it was so fascinating to read that.
Mm-hmm.
But the second thing is that I had some time and Queens that I actually found on Facebook.
Okay.
We connected, and her situation was so traumatic that I flew out there to help her. And here's the thing. As I'm listening to her story, I was like, you know what? The problem is this. Going back to the 45 minutes, that is not enough time to look at the traumas, the abuse, whatever. So I end up creating a tool for her that she used to go to a counselor.
Yeah.
And for the first time in her life, she was able to walk away with a PTSD diagnosis instead of bipolar
yeah,
that she was getting.
That is the major diagnosis, yes, right now.
But that said,
mm-hmm.
so many misdiagnoses, if it's centered so much on trauma, there's a big distinction between trauma and mental illness. So we need to change the evaluation. What's being done?
It's a work in progress. There is no suitable solution to what you're talking about, and we see that all the time. The only thing that I can test what you did was a tip sheet is similar to what we do. Especially when a patient is seeing an outside psychiatrist provider, we send those screening forms. You will be amazed that I have a person who was diagnosed with generalized anxiety disorder who had actually ADD. He was just very anxious. It would get real ramped up. He couldn't sit still, couldn't concentrate, couldn't focus. You know, similar symptoms to the GAD, the generalized anxiety disorder, but not so. We did an ADHD questionnaire form. We sent it with that patient to a psychiatrist appointment. He reevaluated. He actually called us back and said thank you. Because the medication they were giving, it wasn't treating anything. It was on it for months. Wasn't treating, not a thing. As soon as he got his ADHD medication, he was able to focus. He's able to concentrate. He's able to sit still long enough to carry on a conversation. He wasn't rambling. He wasn't stuttering. He wasn't shaking. This is the first sense of normalcy that he's had in a long, long time. So sending questionnaire forms, actually with the screening forms, is very helpful.
I was over there when you mentioned that wonderful thing. But I even found in my own personal therapy with PTSD that it was, even I felt like I was the issue or the problem and I needed to be fixed because a lot of the treatment was based on
fixing the symptoms that I was experiencing, which made me feel like I was wrong again for something that was uncontrollable. Mm-hmm. And rather than considering the situations around me that were contributing to my heightened anxiety, hypervigilance, all of this mm-hmm. stuff, which was, you know, being in a space where I felt unsafe and environmentally and all of those things. Mm-hmm. And even in that, I felt like that was, you know, it was a good diagnosis. We were moving forward, but I still felt like it wasn't focused on me and my experience in the world, but it was focused on my... the symptoms and how to lessen the symptoms themselves.
So how to eliminate the symptoms. In other words, instead of working on you, the whole person of you.
Yeah.
So what happens when you notice that? How do you, for lack of terminology, confront your therapist, say, listen, I know what you're doing, but I think we're gauging this a little bit wrong. This is what I need to work on, because you're in control of your therapy sessions. I tell clients that a lot of times. You're in control of your therapy sessions, so you let me know. And then it's depending on the measure. Was she going by TB, CBT? You know, what type of forms of therapy was she providing?
Sure. Yeah.
So if you're not with the new trends, TB, CBT is very helpful. It actually sits down. You go through your narrative story piece by piece. You break each step piece by piece in order for you to deal with it, not addressing the symptomology, but addressing the flashbacks, the memories, the overall perspective
sure.
of what brought you here. So that's what I would suggest.
Yeah,
don't go any further until you get that distinguished, like, listen, this is not helping me, and it's okay to say that.
And I think that's the most helpful. Once I learned that I was in control of it, that was the most helpful because I felt empowered.
Good.
And I think that's a really helpful thing for you to tell clients to patients because it's, you know, it's also right then and there it builds a sense of trust and control.
And control. Absolutely,
I agree.
Wholeheartedly. Yes.
Oh.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
Yeah, I just found out that I'm working with African American patients, and then also I've worked with some Hispanic and Koreans. I just found that a lot of times, a lot of them come with a very strong faith background.
Yes.
And so, how do we as clinicians leverage that faith background? You know, I mean, without imposing values, you know.
Sorry. Don't impose?
Yep, exactly. But how do we, because they bring that into the counseling.
Then you work with it. You tell them to explain it to them.
Exactly.
You ask them to explain exactly what this means. I don't want to overstep my boundaries. Listen, God, we're not the whole expert, okay? You know, we don't know any and everything. We learn by who we see. And my important thing, when it's something that I don't know, I'm okay to say, look, I don't know, I'm sorry, I'll get back with you. But when it comes to religious background and pieces, I let them explain their religion to me. Because that's a big part of helping them do their moral and core values. Those are their values. And if you can't address those, then that client's not going to be successful in treatment.
The reason I ask that question is that a lot of times, you know, a lot of clinicians kind of shy away from that conversation.
Yes.
Because they feel like they don't really know enough about that particular, you know, religion or anything. Mm-hmm. But I just found that you have to work within that person's faith construct.
Absolutely.
And you don't have to be an expert in it, but they bring that with them. You know, I find that, and you know, I'm not saying it's not the same in the Caucasian community, but in the Black community, and I found out that in the Korean, Hispanic community, faith is a very, very important component.
Yes, it is.
You can't ask a client to leave that out of the door.
Absolutely.
That is very, very important.
I agree. And I bring it into the session. And even too, I have consultants too that I consult with.